morning in our lesson study, and we'll encourage you to continue studying your quarterly and be a part of the discussion.
Very pleasant happy Sabbath morning to you all. Thank you for being in the house of God today on another beautiful Sabbath day as we took time from our personal lives, from what's going on with us during the week, to be in the sanctuary today to worship God. Just want to welcome you, and I hope and trust that we will receive that special blessing that Christ promised to give us as we worship Him. We have some wonderful first-time visitors, and at this time I'm going to ask them to stand so we can get their name, get a little more familiar with them, and we have a special gift for them as well. So if you're here for the first time, I'm going to ask you to stand. In the meantime, special welcome to our online viewers, and we pray that you too will be blessed as we fellowship together, even though you are not here physically, but we know that you're watching and you're participating as much as possible. So welcome, and if you came across our site for the first time, extra special welcome to you as well. All our visiting friends for the first time, please stand. I understand we have some first-time visitors. No? Nobody's here for the first time? A second time? You're here for the second time? Okay, my sister, welcome. Could you tell us your name? Where are you visiting from? Debbie? Jamaica? Oh, Debbie. That's Anna's mom, right? All right, that's Sister Nancy's daughter. All right, Sister Nancy Gilpin, that's her daughter. So welcome, Debbie. It's good to have you. Let's give her a round of applause. And we have a gift for you from Sister Stephanie. Keep standing. At this time, we'll sing our greeting song and special welcome to our regular members.
You're special, and we're so happy that you're here.
Let us sing our greeting song as we get to greet each other in Jesus' name. All around, everywhere I look, your love is all around. Our guitarist, ready? Ready? All around, everywhere I look, your love is all. Come on, let me hear your voices. All around, everywhere I look, your love is all around. Come on, everybody, smile. Everybody, smile. Everybody, smile. Everybody, smile. You're feeling much more welcome and more comfortable. We have a few announcements and reminders. our health officer on duty today, default to Debbie. She's over here in blue, just in case we need that first aid assistant. Can we have it quiet, please? Immediately after divine service today, please listen carefully. Immediately after divine service, Sister Peaches would like to meet with all cast members for the program next week. So if you are involved in the play or the program itself, please meet with Sister Peaches right after divine service. Brother Garth would like to meet with all choir, senior choir members immediately after divine service as well to start rehearsing for next Sabbath. If you're a member of the senior choir or if you'd like to be a part of the senior choir, please meet with Garth right after divine service today. And we are happy to report that baby Jean was born Thanksgiving Day. That's the 20th. I'm not sure, but Thanksgiving Day, we have a newborn baby girl. We have a photograph. I'm not sure if it's ready to be displayed, but if not, we will get that photo to you of the baby as soon as possible. So congratulations to the Jean family on the birth of their baby girl. It's a boy. I apologize, it's a boy, it's a baby boy, and I should know that, right? All right. The community service department, they are collecting blankets to distribute to those who will be in need. So if you have blankets that you'd like to donate, please see Sister Heron or Sister Jamie, and we're collecting non-perishable food items as well. So please, if you have these items to donate, please see Jamie or Sister Heron. And we have a well that's located in the hallway. You can deposit those items in the hallway as well. And we have a letter, or I should say a card. It's a thank you card, and it's from the Henry's family. As you know, they recently lost their father and father-in-law. And it says, dear University SDA family, because of you, there's someone who is thanking God today. Someone who appreciates your warmth and caring way. Someone who is remembering the special things you do and wishing you his blessings every day, the whole year through. On behalf of the family of Brother Joshua Henry, we would like to express our deepest gratitude to all of those who offered their time, service, gifts, flowers, love, and support during our loss. Love, thank you, the Henry's family. So let us continue to pray for the family as they still grieve the loss of their loved one. All right, thank you. Thank you so much for that. Before I go any further, we have some visitors just walked in. It's quite a number of them. We're just going to ask them to stand, and maybe we can have one person. I assume that you're one family. But if not, we just have one person. Could you all stand so that we can see you? Tell us your name and where you're visiting from. Amen. 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 Oh, it's two families. That's okay. It's a big one. Charles Portia Stewart, Ryan Stewart, Ryan Stewart from the Bahamas. Wow. Floyd. Okay, Floyd. Laws. All right. Peach. All the way from Tampa. Wow. Welcome. Welcome on behalf of our pastor and the members of university. We just want to welcome you to our church today. May you enjoy the fellowship and the warmth that we radiate here. And feel free to come again. We have gifts for you. So we'll, at this time, you'll receive your gift. Thank you. Thank you so much. And we have another visitor. Could you tell us your name? Please stand. Don't be shy. Dante? Dante Grace? I'm sorry? his hometown. Thank you, Dante. So on behalf of our pastor, welcome to you as well. Let us give our visitors a round of applause. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. This evening at 2:45 p.m., our Pathfinders will be heading to the conference to help prepare care packages. So let us remember our Pathfinders as they travel and for support. Let us give them our prayers and support as well. And their goal this year is to have 2,500 care packages. So let us remember to pray for our Pathfinders as they are a part of this venture. Elder Hilton Williams is out of the hospital. He's home resting, recuperating. So let us continue to pray for Elder Hilton Williams. All praise team members, you're asked to meet after divine service as well for rehearsal. So we have a lot of activities right after divine service. So right after service, it probably just makes sense that we all just remain for all the activities that we have. And coming up next week, the 17th in the afternoon, we'll be having our wonderful Christmas program under the theme Joy, Joy, God's Great Joy. This promises to be a wonderful program, and we look forward to each and every one of you being here. Let us support this program as much as possible. Invite your family, invite your friends. We have flyers. Flyers are available in the hallway. Please grab one or two. Share with your friends so that we can have a wonderful occasion. We have a concert that starts exactly 4:30. The pre-show is at 4:15 p.m. So please let us be here. And of course, we have refreshments provided for you. So, and it's free. Can't afford to miss it. All right. So next week, Saturday evening, 4:30 for our grand Christmas play. All adult Sabbath school personnel, you are reminded of the meeting to be held at the overflow room following divine service. I'm not sure how we're going to do this, but it will be done. So all Sabbath school personnel, remember to meet in the overflow room. And we have birthdays and anniversaries coming up starting tomorrow. Thank you, Pastor. Brother Dale Henry, his birthday will be tomorrow. Where is Dale? There he is. Dale, can you stand? Officer Dale. Oh, it's Junior. That's Dale Junior. His birthday will be tomorrow. Happy birthday when it comes. And Sister Clarice Wells, she's not here, but she's one of our senior citizens. Her birthday is tomorrow as well. And Kaiti Sanchez, her birthday will be on the 12th. She's also not here. And Sister Sue Hickman, one of our senior, her birthday will be on the 13th. She's not here, but let us continue to pray for Sister Hickman. She's a part of our sick and shut-in prayer list. And we have Lance Lewis. Birthday will be on the 16th. Is Lance here? No? All right. We just want to sing happy birthday to Dale and to all the others who have birthdays. Let's go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
And we have three of our favorite couples who have anniversary. Well, yesterday, the Herons celebrated 50 wonderful years of marriage, I would say. Where are they? They are not here, but I guess we'll see. Oh, Brother Heron is here. All right, congratulations, Brother Heron. And we'll hear more from them later in the day. Brother Elson Clark and Sister Alevina Clark, tomorrow will be their anniversary, and they will be celebrating a lot of wonderful years. I didn't get a figure. I was told to tell you it's a lot wonderful years. So congratulations, Brother Clark and Sister Clark. May God continue to bless your union as you celebrate lots more anniversary. And Brother Lopez, his wife is not here, but Brother Lopez is somewhere around. And they will be celebrating 29 years of marriage. So let us give all our anniversary celebrants a round of applause and may God bless them as they celebrate lots more anniversary. Thank you. Congratulations to all. At this time, Pastor will take over as he has some announcements.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath and welcome. It is so good to be in God's house today, and I have a few announcements to add. I'm doing it now because I have to speak across town, but I have an able replacement whom my wife will introduce in a little while. First things first, we have two new members coming to us from Beacon Light Seventh-day Adventist Church in Phoenix, Arizona. The names are Lukeson and Sasia Brave. This is the first reading. We will have the second reading next time. We are glad that they are here. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. January 11th, we are having, with the rest of the Adventist world, 10 days of prayer. We start on a Wednesday and we continue nightly until the 10th day will be a Sabbath, when it will climax in a great communion celebration service. So that's January 11th. Plan for it. 10 days of prayer, and we are going to be a part of the 20 million Seventh-day Adventists around the world praying for the same thing at the same time. By God's grace, the Lord will answer. What do you say? Amen. Starting in January, on Wednesday nights, we will be studying together, feeding, devouring, reading prayerfully this book, Last Day Events by Ellen G. White. You must avail yourself of a copy, and Sister Jamie has copies for you. I am letting you have them at the price I got them from the conference who gave me a discount. So $6 a copy. It is a treasure, and we will study it together. Some of you may have it already in your library at home. If you don't, get yourself. By the way, where is Jamie? There she is in the back. Sister, you need a copy. See Sister Jamie. She has copies available for you. Powerful book. And we will feed on it. The entrance of thy word bringeth light. We are people of light. What do you say? It is so nice to be here. It's nice to see all of you here. Bon sabbat. Feliz sabado. Yes, and happy Sabbath, Shabbat Shalom. I'm even speaking Hebrew, Lord have mercy. All right, wonderful, wonderful. Now, the year ends on a Sabbath. December 31 is a Sabbath, and so we are going to have a whole year's service right here. We will begin the new year in the house of the Lord with the setting of the sun. I am looking forward to this. We are planning a tremendous program for you. Fellowship, something that will be remarkable to launch us into the new year. You must be here by God's grace. All Year's, New Year's service on Sabbath, December 31. Sabbath, December 31. Now, one last thing. Somebody slipped into my hand. I love it when they do that. They slipped into my hand and they said, don't mention my name, but it says, pay to University SDA Church Building Fund $5,000. Give that person, people, a round of applause. Amen. I will pass this on to the treasurer. Now, Sister Jamie, would you come on up? Because Sister Jamie is the one that moves the thermometer. The thermometer was at 945,000. Dollars raised. A few months ago, I said, by God's grace, we can raise $1 million. And some people said, they were confused. But brethren, the Lord is doing marvelously among us. What do you say? Now, with this 5,000, we have gone to $950,000 raised. We only have to raise 50 more measly $1,000, and by God's grace, this can be done by January 1. What do you say? Do you say praise the Lord? Do you say thank you, Jesus? Do you say I will do my part? By faith, and those online, wherever you are around the country and around the world, we are counting on you to go to the church website, make your contribution. Let's get this thermometer to blow the church top right off here by God's amazing grace. I have not seen a miracle like this in all my years of ministry, and I started way back in 1974. Before you were born. All of you before you were born. But God is so good. Somebody say amen. God is with us. God is among us. And the Lord will do what He alone can do. All He asks us is to do our part. May the Lord bless you as you have a wonderful fellowship and worship today with my friend, my buddy, and my fellow servant of the Lord. He will be introduced to you by my wife in a little while. God bless you all.
Testing. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Thank you, Pastor. You know, let us hear another amen, right, for the amount of money raised. As my wife mentioned, too, economy doesn't seem to be good. People lose jobs, and yet the Lord still provides. So we should praise and honor God for His wonderful blessings. Amen. Psalms 89:9, 89:8. I praise you, God, because who is like you, Lord God Almighty? You, Lord, are mighty. Your faithfulness surrounds you. Amen. Let us stand for our call to worship.
Thank you.
much, Father, for giving us life. We thank you, God, for the air we breathe, Lord, for the reason why we stand, Father. We praise you, God, and we give you thanks. Thank you for blessing us that we'd be able to come here safely. Bless those that are on their way. Bless those that are watching, Lord, that they can sit back and enjoy this service. Father, continue to be with us, Lord, that we may continue to shout and praise your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Smallhorn and the praise team. We're marching to Zion. Amen. The beautiful city of God. And now we'll have our children's story presented by Sister Hazel Williams. So I invite the little children to step forward or come forward.
Children, and happy Sabbath to each and everyone who came out to worship with us today. So boys and girls, today my story is about two frogs. Let me see the hands of those who've seen frogs before, actual frogs. So I guess everybody has seen a frog, right? Okay, so how does a frog move? How does it get from one place to the next? It jumps, right? It doesn't walk, it doesn't fly. It jumps or it hops, right? Okay, and where does a frog usually live? Does anybody know? Yeah, it lives, yeah, you find them in a river. Any place else? In the swamps? In your backyard, right? Yeah, so you see, they are what we call amphibians, and they can live both in water and they can live on land. So these particular frogs, these two frogs were actually sisters. So the older frog, she was lazy and very cautious. The younger frog, on the other hand, she was adventurous and very impulsive, quite the opposite of each other, right? So one just liked to, you know, stay put and very careful about what, you know, she did. And then the other frog, the younger frog, she was one who would want to go out and see, you know, go to different places, you know, experience, you know, have different experiences. So all day, every day, they would be in the pond, and the older frog, she would be on the lily pad, and she'll just be, you know, just lazing around, you know, sunbathing and catching the occasional fly. On the other hand, the younger sister, the sister frog, she would swim and she would, you know, catch all the flies that there were in the pond. But then she got tired of that. And then she decided, you know, let me try to convince my sister to go on an adventure. And she was able to persuade her. So then they went on the land, and they started walking, hopping around, until they came to a barn. And when they got into the barn, they saw this pail on a table. And they decided that they were going to jump up onto the table to see what was in this pail. They got to the rim of the bucket, and then when they looked into the bucket, they saw this white liquid, something similar to water. And they were curious, and they wanted to know, well, you know, it looks so similar to, you know, the pond. Let's go down and check it out and see what it's like. So they jumped into the bucket, and they realized, okay, it feels a little bit like water, but the texture is a little different. It's a little sticky. So they swam around for a little bit, and then they decided, okay, you know, time to move on to another adventure. And then they realized that they had jumped so far down that they were unable to jump back up. You know, they couldn't get to the rim, so they were unable to get out. So then they kept, you know, swimming around, you know, paddling around, and realized that, you know, they were getting tired and they couldn't get out. They continued, and then the older sister, she was like, ah, I'm tired, I'm just gonna give up. There's no hope, you know, we won't be able to make it out of this pail today. And the younger frog sister, she said, you know what, we have to continue in order for us to get out. But the older sister, she decided, you know what, this is just too much, you know, I'm just gonna give up. So eventually, what do you think happened to that frog? Yeah, she drowned, because, I mean, she just didn't continue to paddle, you know, she just, you know, drowned in the milk. And then remember, the milk is not like the water that she's accustomed to. She can survive in water, but she's in the milk now. So anyway, she drowned. But the younger frog, she just continued to swim around, and, you know, she just kept going and she kept going, and, you know, she would make attempts to get out. However, what she noticed that the longer and the more she went around, you know, paddling, she realized that the liquid was now turning semi-solid. So it's not quite hard, but it's getting, you know, harder and harder. And I don't know if, you know, you guys know, but that's how butter is made. Not the entire process, but as you churn the milk, it turns into butter. So because she kept swimming around, the milk turned into butter. And then she was able to keep paddling and swimming around until she was able to get right out. So you see, she never gave up, she just continued. So that is what we say it's perseverance, okay? So doing something that is difficult, just continue doing it, despite the difficulty, that's what perseverance is. And this week, that's what I want you guys to remember, you know. So sometimes you might find yourself in difficult situations, but you just have to persevere. Though it seems difficult, just continue. Say, for instance, you have your math problems that you're not doing well in school. If you keep practicing, with time it's going to get better. So just persevere. And before you guys go, I just want to leave you with this this scripture, this memory verse. It says, but you take courage. Do not let your hands be weak, for your work shall be rewarded. And this is taken from 2 Chronicles 15:7. So who wants to pray for me today? No volunteers? I see a hand.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, and thank you for this story. Thank you for protecting us, forgive us of our sins, and thank you for everything you've done for us. And please bless us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, boys and girls.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hear another amen. Thank you, Sister Hazel. Thank you, children. I don't know about you, but I want to continue to praise the Lord, right? We have our praise and worship team coming. Praise and worship team, let's continue to praise the Lord.
All right, just before we have the praise and worship team, this time I would like to welcome a very special young lady. She was born in this church. She used to sit here just like the kids, have her children, listen to children's story. However, she got mature, moved away to Atlanta, and that's where she's living with her family. And she's none other than the daughter of Brother and Sister Heron, Sister Rosemary Heron, and Brother Derek Heron. And she's an attorney right now. And at this time, I'm going to invite her. She has something special to do. Followed by William.
My name was not told, Miss Eloise. I don't think a lot of people here know me, but I am Chelsea. I was born and raised in this church, and now I am in Atlanta. This is my son, Colin. You know, coming back, it always feels like university is home, but I know a lot of you don't know me, but you know my mom and my dad, and I appreciate you guys for taking care of them when I'm away. I know they can take care of themselves, but, you know, it's always nice to know that they have an additional family here to help them out. So I believe it was announced that yesterday was their 50th wedding anniversary celebration. And a lot of people, you know, yes, amen. A lot of people don't even get to 5 years, 5 days, 5 months. So, you know, to do 50 years is a long time with one person. I'm always like, one person for the rest of your life? Really? Okay, I could do that. But 50 years every day, and you guys work together, and come home together every day? Okay. But they make it work, so I love that for them. And because of them, I am here, and, you know, Colin, of course. So I just wanted to give them a little something. Mom and Dad, if you could come up, please. Come on. I know they don't want to. Yes, come on. Just a little token of appreciation for everything that you guys have done for us. Just wanted to say happy anniversary, and we love you. Thank you. My mom's favorite color is red and red roses, but I also got something else for you guys. Thank you. Okay, Colin. Okay, this is crystal, so yeah, it's very expensive. I'm an attorney, but I'm not making partner money yet, so, you know. Thank you, Ms. Elise. I also went to my grandma's house, and she had some engagement photos of the moment they got engaged 51 years ago. And so this is when they literally got engaged. And it says, love brought you together as husband and wife and gave each of you a best friend for life. Ecclesiastes 4:9-12 talks about, you know, when you have two people, that's a strong bond. But when and you bring God into it, that bond cannot be broken. So I truly believe you guys have had not only yourselves in your marriage, but God, and you put God first every single day. And that's why you guys have survived 50 years, and I hope for 50 more years. If you want 50 more years, I don't know. But, you know, as long as the Lord is willing to give you, I'm very grateful for you guys, and I love you guys, okay? Happy anniversary.
Thank you, church. Thank you very much. We could not have done it without you. University is our solid rock with God. Thank you.
I don't remember this picture, but that time I had a Hafra. Now I can't even grow hair anymore. I can't believe this. Wow. Thank you. I don't remember this picture.
You We should have pretended. Pretend you remember the day. All right, thank you, University. Thank you, Miss Eloise.
Well, is William here? William should be doing another presentation. He's not here.
Praise and worship time. Let the church say
amen.
All right, you know, if you have come here with problems, if you have come here with heartaches, if you have come here with even arthritis, if you have come here with sadness, I want you to all make an imaginary bucket, picture an imaginary bucket, and throw all of that in there. We're going to trade it for the joy of the Lord, right? So you all know where I'm going. I'm trading my sorrows. Amen. So if you're feeling sad, we're going to sing the song, I'm Trading My Sorrows. If you could do me a favor, just come on. Come here, come on. Yeah. We're in the festive season. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Everybody, let's sing. I'm trading, come on.
I'm trading my sorrows.
Make today. I'm trading my sickness.
I'm trading my sickness.
Lord, I'm trading my pain.
I'm trading my pain.
Now all of that, I'm laying them down, down.
For the joy of the Lord.
That's good. We're going to try that one more time. I'm trading my sorrows. Come on.
I'm trading my sorrows.
Yeah, I'm trading my pain. Sing yes, Lord. Come on, say yes now. Sing it with conviction. Let's take it up. So whatever it is, you gotta say yes to the Lord, because He's so much of so much love. His love is reckless. Station. I love the song, even the words, it means a lot. Just help us sing the song. Because it says, when I was a foe. Wrongs I've done in my life, but when I felt no worth,
when I felt no worth,
you paid it all.
You paid it all for me.
Oh Lord, you're so merciful. You've been so, so good.
You have been so, so kind to me.
I'm talking about the reckless love. Come on.
Overwhelming, never ending, shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
Till I'm found and leave the 99. See, I couldn't earn it. I don't deserve, none of us deserve it. Still he gave himself away. Oh, oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Good morning, brethren. A happy Sabbath to each and every one of you. At this time, we're going to have intercessory prayer. You know that we had a hard week. There are many who do not see this day today. We all have problems, burdens. And I pray, God, that each and every one of us may be able to receive Christ as our personal Savior. At this time, we're going to bow our heads wherever you are, whether you're on the seat, whatever. We're going to lift up our burdens and our problems to the Creator above. Eternal, ever-living God, creator of the universe, Lord, you wake us up this morning. You brought us here into this church, most heavenly Father, to give you praise, to give you honor, and give you glory. Lord, we pray, most heavenly Father, that you help us to live a life which is pleasing in your sight. Lord, we are weak, but we know you are strong. Lord, we have problems, oh Father. We are sick, oh Father. But we know that you are the greatest physician that I've ever passed upon the planet Earth. We pray for healing, most heavenly Father. We pray, most heavenly Father, that help us to live, most heavenly Father, the way that you want us to live. That when you come, oh Father, we all may be able to hail you as Lord and Master. We pray, most heavenly Father, for the inmates. They too, most heavenly Father, need you. We pray for those who are homeless, oh Father. Help them, O Father, in this time of needs. We pray, most heavenly Father, for the homeless, most heavenly Father. We pray for the families who are being destroyed, O Father, in one way or the other. That, O God, that you may mend the broken hearts, most heavenly Father. And bring them back together, O God, that you they may be able to see. Thank God for your saving grace. Lord, we pray for our church. We pray for all our members who are sick in one way or the other, O Father. That, oh God, you may touch them even now. Help them to know that there is a God who cares and there is a God who can heal and there is a God who never fails. Oh Lord God, bless them, oh Father. We pray for those who are online, oh God, who are listening, who are unable to come here, oh most heavenly Father. Touch them even now. Help them to know there is a God who loves and the God who cares, oh Father. Lord, we pray for our adventurers and our pathfinders, oh Father. We pray for the counselors, oh God. Help them, most heavenly Father, that you, as they lead in this life, oh Father, that they be the men and women of tomorrow, and that, oh God, whatever we teach them, oh Father, that they'll never depart from it. Oh Lord God, we know that it's difficult times that are led ahead, oh Father. But, oh God, everything works to your name, honor, and glory, because you know everything. Lord, we present, most heavenly Father, the people in Ukraine and in Russia, oh Father, who are fighting for what? We do not know. But Lord God, you know. But Lord God, we pray for the peace and tranquility to reign in this world, most heavenly Father. Because we know that we are just pilgrims passing upon this earth. One day we're going to leave this earth, most heavenly Father. But whatever we do on this earth is not for our own benefit, but for the glory of the Lord. Oh Lord God, take full control, Father. It's time for you to come, oh Father, and that to take your people home, oh Heavenly Father, because this world is not our own, oh Father. We are just passing. Oh Lord God, thank you for your love and your mercy in that while you were yet sinners, you came and you died for us so that each and every one of us may have life and have it more abundantly. Thank you for your love, most Heavenly Father. Thank you for your grace. Lord, we pray, most Heavenly Father, the one who is to bring your word today, oh Father. Oh Lord God, bless and guide and direct him, most Heavenly Father. Let it not be the words from him, but the word from you, that each and every one of us may receive your word gladly, and that we may say it's a good thing that we have come to in the house of the Lord. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you, Lord, for saving grace, oh Father. If it wasn't for you, none of us here would be here, oh Lord. It's because of your love and your tender mercy that's what we are here. We pray for those who have lost loved ones, oh Father, that, oh God, that you may console them in this time, even by the day, oh Father. Oh Lord God, strengthen his family, oh Father. We thank you most heavenly Father for those who have anniversaries, oh Father, even Sister Heron and Brother Heron, oh Father. Oh Lord God, we know the times, most heavenly Father, that you have given them the strength to carry on, and they have carried on even well, most heavenly Father. Thank you for your love towards them, oh Father. Bless them, oh Father. Give them even more years, oh Father, that they may be continue to serve you unto the end. And most heavenly Father, as we live on this planet earth, oh Father, give us the strength and give us the grace to continue to serve you unto the end. So when you come, we all may be saved into your kingdom, we pray. In Jesus' wonderful name we ask in thanksgiving. And let everybody say, amen and amen.
Brother Galvin, beautiful prayer, amen. Let us continue to praise the Lord with our tithes and offerings. Thank you. Loving Lord, thank you again. Thank you, Lord. We want to give you praise. We want to give you thanks. And our thanks is returning back to what belongs to you, which is our tithes and offering. Thank you so much, Father, for giving us the ability to earn what we have, Lord. And more importantly, Lord, I pray for those who are maybe crying out at this moment who don't have a job and who are, Lord, financially not stable. I pray that you may open the doors for them, Father, that they may have a job, that they may be able to be provide to their family, knowing that you're the ultimate one who provides for them, Father. Amen. Give them peace, give them comfort, give them shelter, Lord. And I pray that these funds may go out to those who don't know you as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. May be seated. Remain standing, I'm sorry. And our scripture reading will be brought to us by Carew Brown.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Our morning lesson is taken from Exodus 13, verse Exodus 14, verse 10. And when you find it, could say amen, so we all know you're there. And I'm reading from the King James Version. And for those who have the hard copy, there's a mount at the back, two at the front, so we can all participate. Amen. Exodus 14, verse 10 say, "And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lift up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptian marched after them, and they were all sore afraid, and the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord." Here in the portion of the Lord's word, we indicate by saying amen. May we see it momentarily?
It is my honor and my privilege to introduce our speaker for today, Pastor and his lovely wife, Sister Cindy Etienne. They are well known to our congregation. He spoke to us via Zoom a couple months ago, and she has spoken to us and for women's ministry for Father's Day several years ago. So they are known to our congregation, and we love them. Pastor Etienne is a graduate of several universities. He has a master's in theology, he has a master's in accounting, and he has a master's in public health. So he is well diversified. He began his ministry at Maranatha SDA Church in Miami, where we were, when Pastor King was his senior pastor. And from that time, we developed a relationship. Because they are such a devoted and a sincere couple, we have been friends since that time. After Maranatha, he went to Covenant Seventh-day Adventist Church nearby, and he served there for several years, where he blessed that congregation with his preaching and his talents that God has given to him. He left formal ministry a few years ago, hoping to go into medical school, but the Lord was not ready for that to happen yet. Yet, I say. So we keep praying for him. But they have developed a wonderful couples ministry in which they work with couples. They meet with them once a month, and they take them out on retreats. And they help to mend homes, mend lives that are ferreting away. So we are so grateful for the ministry that they are doing right now. And hopefully he will tell us a little bit more about that ministry. He has been married for 20 years to the lovely Cindy Etienne. And they have four beautiful children. Three girls that are the exact image of their father. The mother didn't have anything to do with it. And they have a son that looks like the mother. At this time, we are going to make a presentation, Sister Eloise. Sister Cindy, would you ask you to come up, please?
Sister Cindy, on behalf of our pastor, his wife, and the wonderful members of University SDA Church, we just want to take time to present to you this little token of our love and our appreciation to you being here to service with us and have your husband to give us the day's message. So on behalf of our church, we just want to present to you this token, and you enjoy it. Give it some water every day, and whenever you look at it, you will remember University SDA Church. Thank you.
Again, we are delighted to have them here today. He loves the Lord, and his great joy is winning souls for Christ. Even though he's not in active ministry, that's his love and that's his desire, that souls be brought to the kingdom. So the next voice you will hear after the music will be that of Pastor Guibert Etienne. May God bless him as he speaks to us today.
I'd like to introduce our speaker, or our singer, I should say, I'm sorry, will be Abigail, Sister Abigail. Hopefully I'm pronouncing your last name, Makawa.
Yeah.
Perfect, thank you.
Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath, church. I hope you're blessed by the song I'm going to sing today. Unchanging, go ye into all the world and share the love of Jesus. far away or door to door. You see it just like somebody told you that Jesus loves you so. You must tell someone who will tell someone until the whole world knows that each one can reach one. As we follow after Christ, we all can lead one. We can lead one to the same.
Somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen, amen. Amen. Sister Abigail, thank you so much for that song, Each One, Reach One. Are you happy to be in God's house today? No, no, come on. Are you happy to be in God's house today? Praise God, praise God. I am so happy to have the privilege to be here with all of you today. The last time I had the privilege of speaking with you, I was on a screen. Something else, boy, I tell you, there's nothing like being inside this church with the family of God. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. I'm so glad. Although COVID is not really over yet, it's not over yet, not by far, but we praise God that we can come together and still worship Him in community. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I'm glad to be here with you. I want to thank Dr. King and Pastor King for allowing me to be here today. I want to thank all the elders and the team that okayed me coming. Praise God. Pastor King, Sister King are very special to us, and we're grateful to God for their friendship, for their leadership in our lives, their mentorship. So we want to let you know that we thank you and we appreciate you very much. And Pastor, he is a really, really good, godly man. Amen? And I'm not just saying that because I like him, because we're friends. He really is a godly man. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And you know that, right?
Yes.
Yes, that is your pastor. You know him by now. And I just want to continue and ask you and plead with you and encourage you, continue to support your pastor and his wife. Amen?
Amen.
God has used them and has continued to use them. He has brought them here to support you in this work. And I just want to encourage you, continue to bless them. They are awesome people. And sometimes it's when we are gone that people say, hey, I remember how he was or how she was. Don't wait till then. Whenever you get a chance, please bless them. What do you say?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I want to praise God again for the opportunity to be here. I'm grateful that my wife was able to drive down with me. We've been married for 20 years. Listen. There was a time that I didn't think I was going to ever get married. There was a time in my life I never thought somebody would ever like me. I remember coming to my dad and I said, Dad, listen, I don't think, you know, it's going to work out for me. This is sometime back in, I think early high school or middle school. And he said to me, son, it's okay. Relax. Wait. Be patient. It's going to come. And would you know, so said, so done. My wife is here 20 years and we have 4 children together. 4. I wanted 6 actually, but she's trying to 6. praise God. Yes, he is. So if my kids are watching online, want to say hello to them. They couldn't make it down with us today. My kids want to say hello to them. My mom is also there as well. She's living with us now. So I want to say hi to my mom, too. I'm glad they are there and they're watching. And y'all better be watching. but I'm glad to be in God's house today. And I have a word to share with you. And I pray that it is a blessing to you as we enter this new year in 2023. Would you bow your heads with me now as we pray? Father in heaven, we're thankful to you today for your loving kindness towards us. We're grateful for your faithfulness. We're grateful to you for your patience. Lord, you have been consistent in our lives. And so today, we glorify you on this, your Sabbath, to say thank you. Father, I pray that you remove me from this pulpit and you step in. Let the words that come out of my mouth be your words. Let what is said be the words that each and every person need to hear. What may not be clear, O God, translate, enunciate, so that they will be able to hear unequivocally and will have the desire to respond to you. Lord, may you be glorified in our lives, I pray. Be with Pastor King as he at this very moment is preaching to. And all the ministers of gospel that are preaching on this day at this time, may you glorify your name through them. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Move forward. Move forward. I've been out of college for some time now, and I remember my freshman year, not too far from me at the University of Florida. I went to UF. When I was about probably, 17. I went to UF. And I remember going to UF was very challenging. My freshman year was the most difficult year of my life, my adult life. And I remember going there not having enough money. My parents sent me with a few hundred dollars. They sent me like $500. And again, it's important to understand that I'm a first generation going into college in my family. And so they mustered up what they could to send me off to school. In addition to that, I was an immigrant. So I didn't have a green card yet. Was not a citizen yet. My only ability to be able to go to school was the fact I got a scholarship to cover my tuition. So on that premise, I went. Not knowing how the rest of my bills would get taken care of, but I went. I remember my siblings telling me, Gibier, stay home. What are you going up there for? You don't have any papers. You don't know anybody. You don't have any money. Stay home. They talk so much, and even my mom and my dad began to say, hey, listen, maybe you should stay home. Because if you're in trouble out there, we can't help you. I said, well, I could stay home. True. There are universities in Miami that I can attend, and not a big deal. But I knew my family dynamics. I knew my friend group. And I knew if I stayed in Miami that I would not amount to much, or it would take me a longer time to get where I needed to be. So I decided to go. I pressed my parents, and they okayed me to go. So I went to UF. Now remember, they said if there's anything happens to you up there, you have no help. Well, UF was difficult. Difficult not because of academics, but difficult because I had no money. I remember there were days, I went days without eating. I remember on one particular day, as a matter of fact, when my hallmates, because we were in the dorm, when my hallmates would buy pizza, I would wait till they ordered the pizzas, and I would go from room to room and took a slice, just to make sure I kept myself going each and every day. That's how I survived, in addition to potluck. So if there are any college students in here? Yes, amen, amen. Potlucks rule. I love potlucks because every Sabbath I went to church, I was guaranteed to go to somebody's house to eat. So if I couldn't have any food during the week, I filled up on Sabbath. Believe me, I ate enough to keep me going for the rest of the week. So here I am trying to survive. And on one occasion, it was days I didn't eat anything. And I remember going to class. It was my music lit class. And I was sitting in class, and I couldn't understand anything that was going on in class because obviously there's no glucose in the brain, in the cabeza, so there's nothing here. And so I am dazed. I'm almost falling out, and all I heard was class dismissed, and I left. And here I am walking back to my dorm room, staggering as if I'm drunk, made it somehow to my dorm room, fell on my bed, fell asleep while I was praying, asking God for help. The next morning I woke up, and I woke up with energy for some reason. Somehow I woke up rejuvenated. I had enough of what I needed to muster to go for the next day, and the next day turned into a month. Month turned into a year. Years turned into the time I graduated. Somebody say praise the Lord. Going to UF was a matter of faith. It was an action of faith. I had no reason why I should have gone, but I had Jesus. And even though, yes, my journey was difficult, even though my journey was challenging, by the grace of God, I made it through and I'm better off for it. Somebody say amen. Amen. So I praise God that I went. I tell you that, my brothers and sisters, today, to tell you that in life, there will be difficulty. Sometimes in life, you have to muster enough courage to step out into the unknown, to step out in faith, even though you don't know what is down the road. Even though there may be challenges and difficulties your way, you must fight. You must push out in faith and watch what the Lord does. That is the decision the children of Israel had to make. When God came and called them out of Egypt, they had to decide whether or not they were going to follow God out into nowhere. You have to understand, for 430 years, they were enslaved in Egypt. For 430 years, they were beaten and told that they were inferior. Every generation, third, fourth generation, all were slaves. Their mom was a slave, their daddy was a slave, their grandparents were slaves. Everybody they knew were slaves. They never knew freedom before, nor did they ever expect to experience it. They heard stories about how their forefathers were once free. But to them, all that seemed like a myth because their reality was slavery. They've never seen it before. And you know what? You've never seen something before. You never experienced it before. It's kind of hard for you to believe in order to accomplish it. And which is interesting. After 430 years, they had grown accustomed to slavery. All they knew was slavery. And as strange as what I'm about to say may sound, their slavery gave them a sense of security. Why? Even though they were beaten, abused, worked long hours, but it's what they were accustomed to. Slavery in their lives was consistent. They knew what role they needed to play every day. They knew when they got up, what they were going to do. They knew when they were going to go to bed. Everything was outlined for them. It gave them a sense of knowing.
You know, it's easy to do a job, and it's easy to continue something when it's all that you're used to. You're comfortable with it. It becomes a part of who you are. And even though it's uncomfortable, it's still secure because you know what to expect each and every day. So regardless of how horrible their experiences were, they accepted it because it's all that they knew. I wonder how many of us in here or watching online stay in a particular situation because it's all you know and because it's predictable. I wonder how many of you remain in a toxic relationship, or you move from toxic relationship to another toxic relationship because it's what you are used to. I wonder how many of you stay in the same job and refuse to take an opportunity for advancement because you are comfortable in the position you're in, even though you need more income. How many of you refuse to get an education so that you can increase the opportunities that are presented to you, even though your spouse or somebody's telling you to do it? You say, nah, because you are comfortable in your situation. Is anybody? Anybody know what I'm talking about today? But thanks be to God. Thanks be to God who does not let us stay in our mess. I don't know how people who don't know Jesus Christ survive, because God does not let us stay in our mess. Thank you, Jesus, that you don't let me stay in my place of comfort. Thank you, Jesus, that you take me out of my situation. Thank you, Jesus. Can anybody here testify that they are thankful that God has been on their side? They are thankful that where you were living, whatever country you came from, that God placed you in a better situation. Somebody say amen. I can tell you today, I thank God that he's been on my side. Thank you, Jesus, that you took me out of that relationship. Thank you, Jesus, that you got me out of that job. Thank you, Jesus, that you were on my side. So while we praise the Lord and give glory to him, what do you do? What do you do when your past won't let you go? You want to get out of it. You want to run away. But what do you do when it won't let you go? Open your Bibles with me to Exodus chapter 14. Exodus chapter 14, reading from verse 1 to 15. Exodus 14, verse 1 to 15. Move forward. Exodus 14. Verse 1 to 15. And I'll read in your hearing as you follow along. I believe it's on the screen for you as well. Yep. Now the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel that they turn and camp before Pi-Hahiroth, between Migdol and the sea, opposite Baal Zephon. You shall camp before it by the sea. For Pharaoh will say to the children of Israel, say of the children of Israel, they are bewildered by the land, and the wilderness has closed them in. Then I will harden Pharaoh's heart so that he will pursue them, and I will gain honor over Pharaoh and over all his army, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord. And they did so. Now I was told the king of Egypt that the people had fled, and the heart of Pharaoh and his servants were turned against the people, and they said, why have we done this, that we have let Israel go from serving us? So he made ready his chariot and took his people with him. Also he took 600 choice chariots and all the chariots of Egypt with captains over every one of them. And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he pursued the children of Israel, and the children of Israel went out with boldness. So the Egyptians pursued them. all the horses and the chariots of Pharaoh, his horsemen and his army, and overtook them camping beside Pi-Hahiroth before Baal-Zephon. And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were very afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Then they said to Moses, "Because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you so dealt with us to bring us out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, 'Let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians'? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness." And Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." The Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward." There are 3 points I would like to make from the scripture to answer the question, what do you do when your past does not want to let you go? 3 points. One, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Two, be still and keep silent. Be still and keep silent. And the third point, move forward. Point number one, don't be afraid. Exodus 14, verse 12 says, "And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were very afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord." Then he said to Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you so dealt with us to bring us out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, 'Let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians'? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness." The Bible says the children of Israel saw Pharaoh's army pursuing them. They were afraid. They panicked. Just moments before, in verse 8, it describes them as walking out of Egypt with boldness. Their heads were held high. Their shoulders were pulled back. They were confident, excited, and happy to know that they were leaving Egypt for good. Then just like that, at the sight of Pharaoh's army, the people threw their hands in the air and panicked. They became afraid. All the memories of the past came roaring back. Their stomachs began to turn into knots. They were vulnerable. They felt vulnerable and insecure. Immediately, they forgot all that God had done to deliver them. They forgot how the Lord had led them by his mighty hand and by an outstretched arm. They looked back, and immediately their joy turned into fear and regret. Look at what verse 11 says. They said to Moses, "Because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you so dealt with us to bring us out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, 'Let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians'? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness." The people began to regret leaving Egypt in the first place. Let me ask you a question, my brothers and my sisters. Have you ever made a decision in your life, a decision to walk away from something or to walk away from someone? Have you ever made that kind of decision, but later on began to question your decision because of difficulty that came up in the new situation? Notice, before they were joyful, jubilant, excited about leaving Egypt, but the minute they saw difficulty, the minute they had challenges, they began to express regret. They saw Pharaoh on the horizon. They saw him coming, and fear began to settle in. They began to wish they had stayed where they were. If some of us are honest today, there are some of us who look at our past in regret. We look back in regret at things we've done in the past. All we can see above the horizon is regret. Our regret of our past shackles us from being able to move forward. Our regret shackles us from being able to press forward and have joy in our lives. It's like rowers in a rowboat. Have you ever seen rowers in a rowboat? Rowers in a rowboat are always moving forward while looking back. Always going forward while looking back. Always looking at the path that you left behind. How are you to live a joyful life when you're always looking behind you, always looking at the past while trying to get to the next destination? Brothers and sisters, fear causes us to develop a rowboat mindset. Fear causes us to forget how God has led us in the past. Fear causes us to forget why he took us out of that situation in the first place. It's for our good, and we know it. But yet, when challenges come, fear begins to settle in, and we begin to have regret. My brothers and sisters, I want you to know today that the Lord will never take you out of a bad situation in order to place you in another one. Oh, y'all didn't hear me. Let me say that one more time. The Lord will never take you out of a bad situation and put you in another one. Understand, Jeremiah 29 says, and this is when they were in the midst of captivity, the Lord says to them, "For I know the plans that I think towards you, plans of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." God has good intentions towards you. He will never take you out of a bad situation and put you in a worse one. Isaiah 41 verse 10 says, "You don't need to fear." God says, "For I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Deuteronomy 31:8 says, "The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be encouraged." Brothers and sisters, the first thing you must know, that no matter what happens, no matter what challenges come up, no matter if your past rears its ugly head, do not be afraid, because God is with you. Don't let the memories of the past trick you into thinking that God made a mistake in leading you to where he's taking you. Don't be afraid. Point number two. Be still and keep silent. Be still and keep silent. Exodus 14, 13 and 14 says this. Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." Another verse says, "And you shall be keep silent." Moses told the people, "Be still and be silent." In other words, Moses was saying to the people, quell your anxious spirit. Be calm and hush the voices in your head and hush your mouth. Why? Well, the truth is, come on, The truth is, sometimes our fears can create negative self-talk. Our fears can cause negative self-talk. Sometimes we tell ourselves that we failed, that we are no good. Sometimes we tell ourselves that we messed up. I should have done that. I should have done this. Our negative self-talk creates doubts, and we become fearful and anxious, which makes us feel vulnerable and insecure. There's a young lady that I know. We're going through a transition, and her work is going through a transition. And sometimes transitions are hard for some of us. Can I get a witness in here? Sometimes change is hard. And so what it did for her, it just brought back so much of her anxiety. And she began to question and doubt in her head whether or not she'll be able to perform at the level she used to with this change and transition. But understand, she's always been performing at a top level. She's always been performing at a high level. But because of the change, because of the disruption, it caused her to become afraid. It has resulted in her head. She began to doubt, began to tell herself that she can't. Will she be able to? We have to fight these negative self-talk. We have to fight through them. Philippians 4, verse 6 and 7 says, be anxious for nothing. When you are negative, when it's negative in your head, Paul says, get on your knees and pray. Be anxious for nothing, but everything by prayer and supplication. Make your request known unto God. And then it says that the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Now, it is also important. I'm going to pause here. Because the truth is, many of us are praying, and we're still negative in our thoughts. My brothers and my sisters, this lady that I know when I was in college, she used to say, if you pray, why worry? And if you worry, why pray? Now, I'm going to be honest in here. It ain't that easy, is it? It's not. But that's why I want to encourage you. If you find yourself in that space, you must get on your knees and pray. You don't stop praying. You keep on praying. And you seek professional help. Counseling can help. It works. Don't pray and ignore counseling. It's important to get help. Talk to pastor. Get professional help. But you need to also do that because negative self-talk will destroy you. Moses understood when he told the people to be still and to be silent because he knew that they were going through things in their head. He understood by their words that they were living in regret. They began to doubt. They began to wander and waver in their thoughts about the decision that they made to follow God out into the wilderness. He understood that they were having anxious spirits. He understood also that when you start in your head, eventually it will spill out. And so they were negative self-talking in their head, but also sharing their thoughts with others. Anxiety breeds anxiety. Fear creates fear. And so as they were talking and doubting and spreading and spreading and spreading, the whole congregation became fearful. And And Moses understood, and he told them to be still and to be quiet. My brothers and my sisters, when you're at church, there may be things that you don't agree with. If there are things you don't agree with, you go talk to your pastor. Talk to your elder. But listen, don't spread your negative thoughts in the church. Don't spread those negative conversations, those fears, and those things in the church. You know why? Because it will create more fear, more discouragement, and it will create instability in the church. And the thing that you want at least will happen because of the fear that you created. Any organization where rumors and negativity spreads will cause it to fall. Keep your negative thoughts at bay. Fight it every day. Don't spread it around to anyone. Ask the Lord to hold you and to keep yourself still. Moses told the people to be still and keep silent so the people can get a chance to see the Lord work. Move forward. Point number three, and our final point. Verse 15 says, "And the Lord said to Moses, 'Why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to move forward.'" When Moses came crying to the Lord was already ready. He was ready to go. As a matter of fact, he had already planned for it. He already told Moses what was going to happen in verse 1 to 4. Look at what he said. He said to Moses, "Speak to the children of Israel that they turn to the camp of Pi-Hahiroth between Migdol and the sea, opposite Baal-Zephon. You shall camp before by sea. For," listen, he already knew, "for Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, 'They are bewildered by the land. The wilderness has closed them in. Then I will harden Pharaoh's heart that he will pursue them, and I will gain honor.'" Listen, "I will gain honor over Pharaoh and over all his army, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord." God had already planned for it. The Lord said to Moses, "Pharaoh is going to say that the people are bewildered by the land, and the wilderness has closed them in, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them." Now, I want to pause here for a second. When the text says he will harden Pharaoh's heart, it doesn't mean that God literally hardened Pharaoh's heart. What it meant is this: God worked with Pharaoh. He tried to encourage Pharaoh to soften his heart, to change his ways. But Pharaoh refused, and God stepped away and let him continue with his plans. There's a reason why I explain that, because I want you to understand that when God is working upon your heart, when God is encouraging you to change your ways, listen and obey. Because you don't want the Lord to step away from you. Because if God steps away from you, you will follow through on your way to destruction. You don't want that to happen. God is working and pleading with us each and every day. Listen. Don't let your heart become hardened, because God's no longer trying to encourage you. Listen when he talks. He's talking about, the text says in Revelation chapter 22, verse 11, "He that is filthy, be filthy still. He that is righteous, be righteous still. He that is unjust, be unjust still." We also put that scripture in the context of the second coming, the time before Jesus Christ comes back. But guess what? We are living in that time. We are living in a time before Christ returns. Let's listen. Don't wait for the Lord to step back and say, "Okay, that's what you want to do? Go ahead." I don't want that. And you know what's so funny? None of us know when the time is going to be, right? I don't know. The point is not when. The point is listen when he speaks to you. Don't resist him. The Lord is coming back. Listen to him as he tries to tell you where to make a change in your life. Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he pursued the children of Israel. The Bible says he came after them, but the Lord had a plan. My brothers and sisters, I want you to know that no matter what your situation may be, no matter what situation that you find yourself in, the Lord's got a plan for you. No matter how difficult it may seem, no matter how bad it may feel, I want you to know that the Lord has a plan for you. Even if you feel like that there is no way out, God has a way out. Thank you. Never doubt that when God is leading your life, that he has a way for you. No matter what people tell you, no matter what they say to you, God has a plan to get you to the goal that he has desired for you. The Lord has a plan. Somebody say amen. Amen. The Lord said to Moses in verse 15, "Why are you crying out to me? Why are you too becoming anxious? I told you this already was going to happen. Tell the people to move forward. Tell the people to move forward in spite of their past. Tell the people to move forward in spite of their fears and anxiety. Tell the people to move forward even though others around them may be fearful. Tell the people to move forward even though they can't see a clear path ahead of them. Tell the people to move forward." Move forward. I remember during the pandemic, my family and I were watching a nature show with David Attenborough. You know who he is, right? Famous guy. So there was this particular animal. It was an iguana. And the iguanas are hatched, I think it's close to water, in the sand or somewhere. And they, in this part of the world, and they have to make a long journey across to get to higher ground. But the path that they have to take is by instinct now. So the path they have to take is instinctive. They have no map, but it's embedded in their brain. Somehow the DNA structure got into them, and they know where to go. But along this path, there are snakes waiting for them, because the snakes know, too, that they have to make that journey. And in the wild, it's about survival. You think it's hard living as an adult, as human beings? It's about survival. So these iguanas have to figure out, they're young now, they're not big and old, they're young now, and they got to figure out how to get from where they are to the higher ground, going through these snakes. And the thing you need to know about snakes, they can't see well, but they can detect motion very well. They can detect movement very well. They are ugly, yeah. Don't like to meet them. So these, these iguanas set, and you know, why didn't they stay where they were? Just make a life and bed where they are and over there in the sand. Why they gotta make this long journey? Why would they just stay in that comfortable sand where it's warm and there's water right there? They're good. But no, they wanna move forward. They wanna get to the higher plane. But getting to the higher plane means that they have to go through the path where the snakes are. So they get, there's a bunch of them, and they go. And the snakes, with instinct, they can hear the pitter-patter of their footsteps. And the minute they go through there, boom, they jump on them. And it's not just one jumping on one. They 10, 15 jumping on one. They all jump and attack them all at the same time. One after the other. Some make it, some don't make it. They go, and they jump, and the snakes attack. And they're attacked, and they're on their hind legs trying to get through, but they can't. I feel like Pastor King just now, but he did this. They go through that path. Brothers and sisters, there is one So we're sitting there watching in horror at all of these animals, these iguanas getting eaten by snakes, because I don't like snakes, and I can't imagine how that feels, having a bunch of them attacking you all at the same time. But there's this one iguana. Oh, hallelujah. There's this one iguana who knows he has to go through, and he takes off, and he goes, and the snakes jump on him. They jump on him, and they bring him down. But he gets back up, and he keeps on going again. Then they jump on him. They jump on him. And he gets back up, and he keeps on going again. Now they bite him now. They bit him all through that. But he gets up, and he keeps on going. They bite him. They jump on him. And he gets up, and he keeps on going. He gets up, and he keeps on going till he breaks through and gets the higher ground. Oh, my brothers and my sisters. Oh, help me preach this, Lord. Listen, listen. In your life, God is trying to take you to higher ground. He's trying to take you to the mountaintop. But the reality is, you and the path that you're taking will have difficulty. It will have challenge. As a matter of fact, the devil is a snake. He can't see where God has taken you, but he can detect upward movement. He can detect when you're going. He can detect that you are progressing forward closer to Jesus Christ. And the minute you start to make a move to Christ, he jumps on you. And he'll bring back your past. He will bring distractions to you in order to bring you down. But you have to get up and keep on going. No matter how much he jumps on you, no matter how much he knocks you down, you have to get up and keep on going. The enemy's not going to stop. He will be relentless. But you have to get up and keep on going until you make it to the promised land. Jesus Christ is coming back soon. And things are not going to get easier as time goes on. But brothers and sisters, we have to trust in Jesus Christ. Hold on to his hand. Even when it hurts. Even when it doesn't feel good. Even when our minds are tricking us. We have to stay the course. We have to remember where we are going and stay the course. Listen, Jesus had to stay on the cross even though it hurt. He said, Father, take this cup from me, but not my will, but your will be done. He was on that cross, the Bible says. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. He was on that cross, and the Bible says, Jesus said, Father, Father, why have you forsaken me? He felt the separation. He felt the pain. So, but he didn't get off the cross. He knew where he was going. He knew you. He knew you. He knew you. He knew you, and he wanted to save you. So he stayed on the cross. He stayed on the cross so that you and I could make it. Even though he was in discomfort, even though he was in pain, he didn't get off the cross because he knew that I was going to be here. Today, if you have not committed your life to Jesus Christ yet, what are you waiting for? This journey along the path to the kingdom can't be journeyed alone. You need Jesus Christ to give you the strength to work through the difficulties, to work through the challenges, to work through the frustration. Today, I want to invite you. If you have not given up to Christ yet, and you recognize that this journey is difficult, I want to encourage you now to commit your life to Christ. Will the audience, everybody stand with me? If you are in here and you have not made that commitment yet, I invite you to raise your hand. Raise your hand so that we can pray for you. If you're online and you're watching, you too can make that commitment. you will receive online on the information for this church, the phone number for Pastor King. Call him, and he can journey with you to a relationship with Jesus Christ. But if you've already made that commitment, you've already committed to Christ, you've been baptized and given life to Jesus Christ, and today, you know your journey, but you've fallen along the way. Sometimes it's hard to get up. And if you find that you want the Lord to give you an extra strength, if you want the Lord to bring someone alongside you to help you along this journey, if that is you, please come join me up front so we can pray together. It's important, brothers and sisters, that you are okay with your story. Until you can accept your story, until you can be comfortable with who you are, the journey will be even more difficult. Daddy Iguana knew who he was. He knew. And he knew what he needed to do. Don't worry about anybody else in here. Be comfortable with your story and make this journey to Jesus. I thank you for those who have come. So for the rest of you who have chosen that chose not to come, you now are tasked with praying and supporting those who began to make this journey. You are tasked with coming alongside them to ensure that they don't make it alone, to ensure that they make it successfully. So I'm going to pray that the Lord will provide coverage for all of you here that are in front, that he'll give you the faith and the strength you need to fight through the difficulties, to fight through the pain, to fight through the negative self-talk through the power of his Holy Spirit. I'm asking the congregation, close your eyes and bow your heads as we pray. Come on, you coming, come on. Come on. And if you're online watching, I invite you to close your eyes too. As I'm praying here, I ask you to raise your hand online so that I can pray for you too and acknowledge the Lord in your life. Father in heaven, I pause here to say thank you for the men and women, boys and girls who have made this journey down to these steps. Even though it's not a far walk for them, it is a courageous walk, dear Lord. I ask, Heavenly Father, knowing each and every single one of them, while I cannot call them by name, you know their names and you know their story. I ask, Heavenly Father, that you do a mighty work in their lives. That you give them strength, oh God, to stay the course with you. If they have fallen by the wayside, God, let them know a righteous man falls 7 times, but gets up each time. Amen. Help them not to stop getting up. To hold your hand each step of the way. But Father, there will be times when they don't have the courage to. And you know that. That's why I love you so much, Jesus. Because you know there will be days when we don't have it in us to come to you. Thank you, Jesus, for coming after us. You made the first move. Jesus, you stepped out first. Your word says we love you because you loved us first. So, Father, let no one in this place today feel any way when there are days when they can give you more. Let them know that you understand. As long as they don't give up, you will hold on to them. I pray for those, oh God, who are walking this journey with you. I pray, Father, that they will come alongside those who may need just a little more encouragement, just a little more help. Please help them to be committed to doing so. But while they're helping others, like Paul says, but not be lost themselves. Let no one in here ever think they are strong enough that they don't still need your Holy Spirit each and every day. And Father, for those who have not given their lives to you yet, may they do so swiftly. And when it's all said and done, may you receive all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. In Jesus' name we ask, amen and amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's hear another amen for our pastor and his message that the Lord brought to us. Amen. How many of us have been blessed by the message today? Amen. Praise the Lord. Those online, we see your hands rise too as well. Praise the Lord. Our closing hymn will be number 440. Number 440, How Cheering is a Christian's Hope. Let us stand.
Father, we're thankful, and we look forward to that blissful home. As we leave this place today, may your Holy Spirit never depart from us. And may we continue with you each day of this week to come. And may your name be glorified in our lives. Father, let none of us be lost, so that when you come back, we all together can celebrate and praise your name for all that you've done in our lives. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
Okay, we have a late announcement. This time of the year, we have this program. It's called the Angel Tree. The tree is now set up in the hallway. So on your way, we are asking members to take an angel. At the back, there is information as to what to do. This is geared towards inmates. This time we'll be collecting gifts for children of inmates. So we have on the back of those angels like little gifts, like whatever, like clothes or whatever it's written on it. So we're just asking you to take an angel and whatever you can do so that we can spread love and joy to the children of inmates. If you need further information, please speak with Allison or Marcia. And a quick reminder, we have the senior choir rehearsal, we have the Sabbath school meeting, and we have a praise team, and we have the cast. So please, as much as possible, and let us see how best we can divide ourselves, and so that we, because time is short, next week is a program, and we have a lot to do. Thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of the Sabbath.
Amen. With all those meetings, we might as well stay, right? Yes, Lord, you'll be ushered out as we sing, yes, Lord. I'm trading my sorrows.
I'm trading my sorrows.
I'm trading my
Lord.
Yes, yes, Lord.